Here's a proverb for you. A man does not know when he is well off. It is only when he is poor that he remembers the days of plenty. Hi friends, this proverb is from Kenya. Bold, beautiful Kenya. Kenya is possibly one of the more popular African countries, with the safaris and the Swahili language, possibly the setting of Lion King and being home to part of the Maasai tribe. But obviously there is much more to Kenya than all of that.
Yep, there is food. Obviously there's more than food, but since this podcast is about food, we're going to say there is food. And the food we tried here is beef pilau, which is a rice, potato, and a beef dish.
Kenya sits in East Africa and is bordered by Tanzania to the south, Uganda to the west, South Sudan to the northwest, Ethiopia to the north, Somalia to the east, and the Indian Ocean to the southeast. It has a population of about 47 million people, and the capital city is Nairobi. It was once a British colony, and so English is one of the official languages. The other official language is Swahili and is also the national language. But there are over 70 languages spoken in Kenya.
I have mixed feelings about Kenya because I really want to visit. It's one of the countries I would really love to visit in Africa.
Me too.
But I low-key hate on Kenya because, and this is not Kenya's, anybody who's Kenyan, we apologize. This is not your fault. But because Kenya has the safari and the Lion King and all of that stuff, those of us who come from countries that don't have that kind of vegetation are subjected to that stereotype.
Oh, like you guys have safari and lions.
Yeah, they're like, oh, lions. And I'm like, we do not. We don't have, not a single lion do we
have.
So
you're taking out your own trauma on
Kenyans. No, because people will be like, and it's funny, every time someone said, oh, you're Nigerian, it was always, I've been to Kenya. And I'm like, well, that's great for you. I'm happy you've been to Kenya, but that's not, that's
it's
nothing
not
to
even,
do with
it's
what
not
I
even
said.
The same part of like, the continent.
No, it's not even like, where in the west, this is in the east, the vegetation is completely
like, oh,
different.
Hi, you're African, you're Nigerian, right? Oh, I've been to Kenya, it's so pretty. Like, I haven't been there, it would be nice, tell me more.
Do you know your neighbor from five streets down? How will I know your friend from Kenya? Like, I don't, it's so fresh.
You're burnt.
I'm very burnt. So Kenya, please, this is not your fault. It's just we're suffering for the beauty of your country.
Yeah,
I guess.
You're just beautiful and popular, so.
And everybody's taking it out on us. It was even like a, I won't say which airline, but it was an issue a couple years ago where the US played Ghana in a game. And I think they had the Statue of Liberty and then they had a giraffe and they were like, oh, US victory over
what?
Ghana. And people were like, there is no giraffe in Ghana. Like,
oh my
so guys,
word.
Please, if you're,
how
if,
much did they pay somebody to make such a huge mistake?
I don't know. I just want to tell you this. If you are guilty of this kind of thing, up until now, we forgive you. But now you know better. Please don't meet an African person and go, oh, do you know my friend from Kenya? Or ask them if they've seen a lion. The first lion I saw was in a zoo in London. I've not seen a lion. There's nothing wrong with seeing lions and safaris are beautiful, but don't just assume, because if you assume, I'll go and take it out on a poor Kenyan person and be like, see the problems you're causing for us.
It's not their fault, you know. Kenyans have done a very good job of tourism and marketing. Mm-hmm. That's actually pretty fantastic.
Oh, it is. It is. Anyway, let's get back to our podcast. I'm done ranting.
Okay, you good?
Yes, thank you.
You good?
I got it out.
Okay. There's a long history of trade between East Africa and India, as well as East Africa and the Arab world. Because of this, the food in Kenya has indigenous African, Arabic, and Indian flavors.
Nice mix.
Yeah. So before we get into the good stuff, which is the food stuff, you can support this show by virtually buying us a cup of coffee, shopping through our affiliates, or even sponsoring the ingredients in an episode. So yeah, check that out on our website or blog using the link in the show notes or on our social media pages. Now, onto the good stuff. So in Kenya, you can find different types of stews, seafood, vegetables, and meat. First, there is nyama choma. This is grilled meat that could be goat, beef, or chicken. You can also find mutura, which is grilled, spicy, and flavorful blood sausage. You know, that blood sausage is actually pretty popular.
I think even the first time I heard of it, though, was even outside of the continent. I think in the UK.
Yeah, yeah.
A lot of people eat blood sausage. I don't really know what it is, though. But
it's sausage with blood mixed into it.
Oh. Well,
legit,
then.
Yeah.
Right, okay.
Yeah, I heard it's pretty tasty. I haven't tried it, but I heard it's pretty tasty. And from what I read, Kenyans have one of the best ones, because unlike, you know, some other ones, theirs actually have all those flavors and spices inside, so it kind of it gets you.
Interesting.
Anyway, you can also find ugali, and this is a staple dish made with maize meal and hot water stirred into a stiff porridge. Think of something similar to fufu or banku. You can often eat it with sukumawiki. Sukumawiki is made from collard greens, onions, and tomatoes. And just heading back to fufu real quick, if you haven't tried it yet, there was a whole trend going on between late December, early January 2021 of people trying out fufu for the first time.
Oh yeah,
it's pretty interesting. Check it out on, I think it was TikTok and social media. But so if you are someone who is outside the continent or you have never tried it before and you want to see people's live reaction to tasting it, because for us we're used to it so we kind of know what it tastes like, but if you wanted to get that visual reaction and see how people felt about it, then
Just to add to something that Yemi had said about ugali, when we say it's like fufu, we're not referring to the taste or really even the texture. It's more of the appearance, because it's, this one is maize, it's not like cassava or anything like that. And to be perfectly honest, this is an aside, but I'm not sure if I've actually had fufu, like proper traditional fufu.
I have the ingredients at home. It's here.
Okay, well, you can make it yourself.
You don't want?
No, I'm okay, thanks.
Wow. Okay.
Because I've had like plantain fufu and all, but the actual fermented cassava fufu, not so much. Anyhow, going back to the kind of food you can find in Kenya, one major one that I have loved from the day I tried it is chapati. Chapati is a flat bread, and I don't know how to describe the goodness of it. It's very thin. It's kind of flaky. It's slightly sweet. It's just, it's so beautiful. The first time I had it, I was like, what is this? And ever since then, whenever I went to, they probably got tired of me. If I went to someone's house and the person was my friend who was Kenyan or Tanzanian, I'd be like, please, is that chapati? And then one day my friend was like, you cannot just go to somebody's house and because the person is Kenyan or from Tanzania, you expect to see chapati. Stop it. It's rude. So anyway, I'm not beyond begging, guys. If you want to send us some chapati, I'll take it. Thanks.
I've never tried it, so I'll take it too, I guess. Oh, Ijaba so seems good. To be in love.
Oh, I love chapati. Janet, if you're listening, please make me chapati and send to me. Thank you.
Wow. She's begging on air. All right. Keep
anyway,
going.
Apart from chapati, you can find kupaka. Kupaka is like a coconut curry sauce. There's also kachumbari. That's a salad. It makes me think of a salsa, actually. It's tomatoes, onion, cilantro, lemon juice, green chilies. And then you have a stewed green plantain called matoke. You have snacks like bajia, which is a deep fried potato snack. And I think the bajia might be one of those things where the influence might be from Asia. And then you also have samosas, which also have links to India. Kaimati, which are sweet dumplings. And then mandazi. Mandazi is a coconut and cardamom donut that we talked about in our first special. So have a listen to that if you haven't yet. It's called Coffee and Donuts. And you can find more information about Kenyan cuisine on the blog. These are just a few examples. One of the things I did want to mention, though, was we talked about the history between East Africa and India. I don't know about you, but I find that moving out of Africa introduced me to a lot of other Africans and I learned a bunch of things.
Yeah.
So one of them was the concept that there were people of Indian descent who could trace generations back to East Africa as well as South Africa. But I remember I had a friend who was from Kenya, but by descent he was Indian. And when I say like he lived there, his parents lived there, so he identified as Kenyan. And I was like, well, that makes no sense because you're not black. And he was like, well, my whole family, like there's a large community of people who can trace generations back to living in Kenya. Do you know, with me and my other friend, with our typical arrogance and ignorance, first year Nigerians coming to a different country with our chests held high, we're like, no, you're actually not Kenyan. We don't know anything about Kenya, but wow. We as Africans, we're telling you, you are Indian.
Are you serious?
And then he was so sweet. We eventually became friends and I learned things and learned to keep my tongue in check until I...
until you did your own
until
research.
Until I gained sense.
You know, there are some times where you see someone who looks Caucasian and they speak and you get taken aback for a second. It can be jarring.
It was like I was very, you know, confused and arrogant about it. So I had to bite my tongue. Yeah. So moving on to a feature dish. It is called pilau, as we said. You make pilau with rice and potatoes and a special blend of spices called pilau masala. This is different from garam masala. So the pilau masala has cumin, cardamom, cinnamon, cloves, and black peppercorns. You can buy the pilau masala or you can make your own following a recipe. The pilau recipe that we used also had a recipe for the masala, so I went with that and made it from scratch.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that happened though when I was making the pilau masala was that the recipe asks you to take these whole spices, the cumin, cardamom, cinnamon, cloves, and black peppercorns. You take them whole, you toast them, and then you blend them, right? Now, I also had fennel in the pantry,
mm-hmm.
and fennel and cumin look almost identical. That actually brought out, oh, Yemi's giving me the side eye because this has happened many times before. I almost brought out the fennel and used that instead of cumin, and then I noticed at the last minute.
Yay!
She was like, I dare you to say you used the wrong spice.
I actually gave her dead stares just now. I was
No, I used the right one. So, anyhow, you have your pilau masala, you have your rice, potatoes, pre cooked beef. So, however it is that you want your beef to taste like, you cook it on the side. You have garlic, onions, salt, some hot water, and again, your masala. Now, the recipe I used stated that garlic is optional, but she really liked it, and so she used it. And I like garlic too, so I used it. So to make the pilau, you chop the onions, and then you fry the onions on low heat until they are brown. Now, this is the most important part of making your pilau, because a big chunk of the color is going to come from the onions. And you want to make sure that your onions are brown, but not burnt. So you actually have to watch it very carefully while you're cooking it. You continue to cook it carefully on low heat until it turns brown. And this could take a while. I'm not going to lie. After 10 minutes, I was tired. So I turned up the heat. But if you're going to do that, you have to be even more conscientious in watching it to make sure it doesn't burn, because you don't want your onions to burn. Now, once the onions are browned, you've kind of browned up the oil as well, because I should have said, obviously you're going to use some oil to fry the onions. Once the onions are browned, you add in your potatoes and your garlic, put them in together and cook for about 3 to 4 minutes. Once that's done, you add your masala and a little bit of salt. The recipe I used didn't specify salt. I'm guessing it was left out by accident, but you do need some salt. After you've added that and cooked it, then you add your beef. And then you add your rice, and then you add your water so that the rice can cook in the pilau, in the sauce. Now, the ratio of rice to water that I used was 1 to 2.
Okay.
So, and then I think once you've added the rice in and you cook till done, it takes about 30 minutes to cook. So I would say entire cooking time, maybe about, well, it depends on how conscientious you are with your onions. It could take anywhere from 45 minutes to an hour and 15 minutes.
Okay.
But a good chunk of that is you carefully browning your onions to make sure that it's fine. Now, something to mention is you might not be able to tell from the pictures, but I did not peel off the potato skin. And that's more because of the kind of potato I was using. If you're using regular russet potatoes or the regular potatoes where you peel off the skin, yes. But I use creamer potatoes because those are the only potatoes that people are allowed to eat in my house. And there's a reason behind that. But long story short, I use creamer potatoes, and creamer potatoes are small potatoes. They're grown as a smaller variety and they don't need the skin peeled off. So that's okay. Why you might see that it looks like there's skin on it. So if you get regular russet potatoes, peel that.
Okay. So to describe what we're eating, it's brown looking rice with potatoes and meat sticking out. Lol. Like, seriously, it's not really made of brown rice.
Did you say lol?
Yes, I did.
Okay, lol. I said lol.
It's not made with brown rice. You use regular rice, but the spices and the onions give it the brown color and coating. Not quite as brown as kudu karis from our Djibouti episode, but not as red as jollof rice, which is cooked in tomato sauce.
I mean, your description is the best description that was ever described in description history. Are you done?
Yes.
Okay. So what she said, that's what the rice looks like.
This rice that looks brown. I don't know.
Did you like it though?
Yeah, I don't know. It was nice, yeah. I have to confess that I had to add more salt and pepper.
Why did you add? It's not okay. Why did you have to add pepper?
Okay. In fairness, I did it after the first bite.
Okay.
So I had the first bite to taste, and then I was like, this baby needs some salt and pepper. You gave me a huge bowl. How was I supposed to finish? I couldn't. But after that, I was like, food has arrived. Yes. The spices themselves actually came together pretty nicely. Like, having the potatoes and rice, not something I've tried before, you know. And, okay, confession number two. After the first couple of bites, I actually separated the rice and potatoes. I was like,
I don't understand. You picked out the potatoes.
Yes. I shifted the potato to one side. I shifted the rice to another side. So I ate my rice and meat. Then I put some meat to the potato, put some meat to the rice.
So you had two dishes, basically.
Pretty much. At first, I had... Okay, so I had my first bite. And I was like, okay, this is nice. I like the flavor. I really would like some more salt and pepper. I added that. And then... After a while, I was like, why does it still feel strange, though? I was like, oh. All right, let me see what else. So I now started eating just the rice. I'm like, this rice is really nice. So, and so as I was eating it, I was not realizing that, I was subconsciously, like, shifting the potato. I was not like, a potato that cannot come and waste. And I was like, eating the potato.
So, I ate beef pilau. Yemi ate rice and meat, and then potatoes and meat.
With salt and pepper.
With salt and pepper.
Okay. It was good, you know. I still struggle with the idea of eating like rice and potatoes. Like so much, you know. But in terms of flavor, it was really... I think the onions themselves, like it has that burnt onion. Okay, I don't know if I'm the only one, but I really enjoy eating burnt onions.
I don't do it, but I can see it. It's sweeter. So yeah.
If you've had onions burnt and you've snacked on it before, so that flavor actually kind of comes true, and so the food actually tastes like pretty nice. Like especially with everything you add, it's just the burnt onion flavor.
Can you stop saying? Do you know? I feel bad now because if the person who created this recipe that I borrowed it from her, as you saying burnt. She was very
okay. Brown.
She said, "Don't burn the onions." Now it looks like I burnt the onions.
It's not burnt. It's me. I said the taste of burnt onion is what it reminded me. I'm not saying that you burnt the onions. Okay. Don't be angry. Mm-hmm. Yeah. How did you? What do you think, Yusuf?
I liked it. I think for me, again, this is where I have to encounter biases that I didn't think I had. Whenever I taste a certain combination of spices that usually involves cloves, cinnamon, cardamom, and it's not in a cake or a cookie or something baked, I'm a little taken aback. And for someone in my mind that I thought, I try everything, I enjoy everything, I really liked the dish.
Yeah, it's pretty nice.
It's pretty nice. Like, I think it's just visually, my head was, as I was adding the masala in, my head was getting used to the concept of adding these spices in. Now, the difference is that Scudicaris also had tomatoes.
Mm-hmm.
And because Scudicaris had tomatoes, I could more visually understand that because to me, rice and tomatoes go together very well. With jollof rice, with stew, with all kinds of sauces. But when I started seeing cloves, because I bake, when I started seeing cloves and all those other things, I was like, really? Okay. I know at the back of my head, these are East African spices, right? North African spices. That said, I think I was like, it wasn't like I was hesitant. I was more a little concerned before I tried it. But then I tried it and I really, really liked it. Again, I referred to Scudicaris because we used some of those dishes. And I liked, it was like a very earthy... I think it tastes out earthy, slightly spicy.
Yeah.
By spicy, I don't mean hot.
Toasting the cloves. Mm-hmm. So if you toast, toasasting the cloves gave it that, like, earthy flavor. Almost like earthy, but barbecue-y, but not quite barbecue-y, but like tasty.
Another one that's strong, because in the pilau masala, the largest quantity, like the spice that features most prominently is cumin. Mm. And you could definitely taste the cumin come through in the rice. That's the thing. If you ever tasted cumin powder, the rice would make a lot of sense if I tell you it has cumin in it. Because that was like...
Wait, by cumin, do you mean curry?
No. Cumin is a spice itself. Just cumin. Cumin is one of the features of a curry because there's no such spice as curry. Curry is actually a blend of spices.
What?
Yeah. A curry has different spices. Sometimes it has cumin. It definitely has the yellow one that makes everything yellow. Turmeric. Okay, so now you've learned something new.
I did.
Long story
short, I should like, share, and subscribe.
You should like, share, and subscribe
because I learned something new. Okay, So that's all we have for you today. We hope you've learned something new, like I did. Stay kind, be good, maybe try some pilau. And we will see you on the next episode when we come to you from Southern Africa.
Goodbye. Thank you for listening. While the podcast airs every 2 weeks, we have a backlog of episodes just waiting for you to enjoy.
The show is a collaboration between Tunuka Media and 234 Pantry.
Africa in My Kitchen is produced by Tunuka Media and co-hosted with 234 Pantry. So while on Instagram, visit both Tunuka Media and 234 Pantry. With Tunuka Media, you'll find out about more shows produced which aren't necessarily food-related, while on 234 Pantry, you will get more food-related content.
For example, Tunuka Media also produces another show called Overlooked, which I host. All the links with the relevant information to connect with us are located in the show notes. Like, subscribe, and share within your community. We'd also really love for you to give the show a high rating wherever you enjoy your podcasts.